Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us in this talk called Water, Agriculture, and Food Security. I am pleased to introduce to our speaker, Dr. Chandra Madramootoo. Dr. Chandra Madramootoo is Dean of the Faculty of Agricultural and Environmental Science of McGill University. He is an internationally respected expert in water table management, irrigation, drainage, water quality, agricultural research, and international agriculture development. Thank you, Dr. Madramootoo, for joining us. Please.
Thank you very much, Carol. And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Are you hearing me clearly there?
Yeah, we can hear you very well. Thank you.
Thank you. I apologize that I was not able to do this properly at the last time when we spoke through the web connection, but I'm happy that the system seems to work better now. So I appreciate this. I'm sorry that we have to do it so early in the morning for our friends in Latin America, but nonetheless, I'm happy that we can correct it. I was given 5 points to cover by Mr. David Williams, and I think you have the 5 points with you that you would like me to cover today. So I would like to start with point number one. What do you see as the most relevant challenges to water for food security in Latin America and the Caribbean? In my view, the biggest challenges are with respect to floods, and we see this in many parts of Latin America, South America particularly, where we have large river systems that we see the impacts of floods and the disasters caused by floods on human life, damage to agricultural land, and damage to crops. We see this as well in the Caribbean region. We also have the impacts of droughts, and we notice that with droughts that there are problems that will lead to water shortages and water scarcity as a result of droughts in Latin America, in the Caribbean, and the impact of droughts, of course, being severe with respect to food production and food availability, as well as the same for floods. We have floods that do cause damages to crops and croplands, and this also has an impact on food security. There is, I think, well hypothesized that some of these extreme events of floods and droughts are due to climate change impacts, and the changes in temperature and precipitation that we're witnessing in some parts of Latin America and the Caribbean is probably could be attributed to the floods and droughts, or the floods and droughts, could be attributed to some of these changes in climate and climate change impacts that we are witnessing. We should also not forget the impacts of water quality degradation and water pollution. This is also extremely significant in Latin American countries. We see this quite a bit with respect to non-point source pollution from agriculture, and also with respect to point source pollution from municipalities and also from urban areas and industrial areas as well. Inadequate management of our water resources is something that we must be concerned about, because we believe that not enough attention is being paid to integrated water resources management and how we could use our tools with respect to looking at water in a much more holistic manner to be able to manage the resource, the water resource, in an integrated way. And so our institutions are very fragmented, and not only are our institutions fragmented, but we also have very weak governance mechanisms and weak governance systems to be able to manage water effectively. So there's very little emphasis on integrated water resources management in Latin America, Caribbean region, and inadequate attention to the management of the resource by our political leaders and politicians and decision makers is a cause of concern for the management of this resource. There's also a very low adoption to technologies. The region, the Latin America, Caribbean region, is very slow to adopt new technologies in water management, particularly in irrigation, new technologies in irrigation, new technologies in integrated water resources management, the adoption of tools to manage water effectively. The region has been very slow to adopt these new technologies. And as I indicated earlier, some of these problems that we're witnessing with respect to improper management of the resource, and also some of the problems with floods and droughts and so on, and how to mitigate against floods and droughts could be attributed as well to our weak institutional mechanisms and governance mechanisms for managing water in a holistic way. So there's certainly a call for improved governance of water resources management in Latin America, Caribbean region, and at the same time to undertake the necessary institutional reforms to better manage water. This also touches on the point of pricing mechanisms for water. We do not have very strong instruments in the Latin America, Caribbean region, with the exception of some countries. We know, for example, in Argentina and Chile, much has been done on pricing of water, allocation of water, using mechanisms that are based on water pricing and legal aspects of water, water rights, and water pricing mechanisms, which, while being implemented in some Latin American countries, by and large in the EU member states, there has been virtually very little attention to how we can use best practices in water prices and mechanisms, legal rights to water, and jurisdiction over water to be able to better manage water resources. So these are some of the challenges that I see for water resources management in Latin America and the Caribbean. This then brings me to the second point that I was asked to address, and that is how are irrigation institutions responding to the needs of small farmers? What can or is being done to ensure more reliable delivery of water, increased transparency in its management, and balance efficiency with equity in access to water? Well, I have to say that overall, very little has been done in this area in Latin America and Caribbean region. There has been very little attention, as I mentioned before, placed on integrated water resources management, with the exception of some countries, but this is by and large far and few between. So attention to a unified approach to water resources management that also takes into account the environmental demands for water, and to look at water management in a holistic way, I think has been one of the underlying reasons and underpinning reasons why we have seen very poor response by irrigation institutions to the needs of small farmers. So what can be done to improve and ensure more reliable delivery of water, increase transparency? But I think one of the first things that can be done is in terms of the establishment or creation of irrigation advisory services. The region, Latin America, Caribbean region, and again, Latin America, Caribbean region, I should emphasize, is a very large region with a lot of variability between the 30-something countries that belong to LSE. And so when we talk about what can be done, one has to bear in mind that some countries are doing more than others, some are doing very little, and we have to recognize the variability and the differences in scale between in water resources and water availability from country to country. We can go to a country like Antigua, in the Caribbean, which has virtually no water and depends exclusively on whatever the rainwater it has, and then some desalination water. Much larger countries, when we think of places like Brazil, Argentina, Venezuela, with large river systems, many countries don't have in Latin America, and in the Caribbean and parts of Central America, don't have access to that kind of resource. So one must bear in mind that because of the differences in the scale at which water is utilized, Antigua being a very small country with very little agricultural activity, of course, not very much is being done. The question is, could more being done? Could be done with the investment? These, of course, are very difficult decisions to make compared to other larger countries in Latin America, which have more established irrigation departments and ministries that tackle water. So there's variability, but I certainly think more can be done with irrigation advisory services. Much more can be done in the area of technology transfer. But I think that overwhelmingly, when I look at the entire Latin America Caribbean region, where we could play a much bigger role is in terms of improvements in water delivery and transparency, to have transparency mechanisms in the management of the resource. I think it's very fair to say that as you go across the region, you will find that there is not much transparency in how the decision making is made with respect to allocation of water. In many cases, it's a very top-down approach in the way water is allocated. Very little participatory stakeholder approaches in mechanisms for water resources sharing and water resources allocation. I wouldn't even go as far as to say that the stakeholders have to be all the people in the ground, on the ground. That is true for sure. But when I look at the many departments, ministries, and institutions at national and within countries, regional skills within countries, we see that there is very little coordination between the different institutions at the municipal level, at the state level, at the federal level, at provincial level, in terms of effective management of the resource. Every single institution that has some jurisdiction and say in water resources management uses a very siloized approach. They take approaches along silos, compartmentalized approaches, looking after the unique interests of their own individual stakeholders or ministries, the jurisdiction that is appointed to those ministries under political powers, but not coming together. These institutions are very slow, very reluctant to come together in terms of sharing information, sharing data in order to be able to manage the resource much more effectively. So we need much more transparency in the management of the resources at all levels. We need to have a more holistic approach and look at how we manage water, taking into account the growing environmental demands for water. This is something we cannot underestimate or ignore, that there is increased importance on being able to satisfy the ecological demands and ecological requirements of water. Let me say that if we are going to improve decision making for the allocation of water for various provision of water for agriculture in all forms, whether it be irrigation, drainage, fisheries, aquaculture, forestry, we need to have a much better monitoring and data sharing system than I see currently prevailing in many of the Latin America and CARICOM countries. We need to be able to establish national networks within countries. We need to be able to establish state networks that feed into a national or federal system for data collection and data sharing, so that all stakeholders at governmental levels, municipal levels, irrigation agencies and irrigation districts can have access to this water for access to this data base. in terms of allocation of water resources. Let me give one example in this regard that we have been working on at McGill University with our partners at CARICOM and the Caribbean countries, and that is a project that we led here at McGill University with funding from the Canadian International Development Agency to set up national water information systems, which we have been able to participate with in Grenada, Guyana, Barbados, St. Lucia, and Jamaica. And this has allowed us to bring new tools, new technologies, information technologies. Today, with large access to data that we can obtain from satellites, from remote sensing, from Google Images, and so on, and then to put all of this into GIS databases, to be able to put all the data from our monitoring stations, water quality and water quantity monitoring stations, our agrometeorological stations, to provide all of this. Now that this data can be collected electronically, can be put onto servers and can go in, that have been collected by wireless signals and put into database systems, and having dedicated agencies that can process the data, I think, and display the data in such a format and a way graphically and with data tables and some analysis of the data that will allow decision makers at very high political levels to make decisions about allocation of water, I think is extremely important, and I think we should call for more of those kinds of systems being created in Latin America and the Caribbean. We also need to have equity and access of water through stakeholder participation, through water users associations using participatory approaches, bringing farmers groups together, cooperatives together, and more that the water users themselves, the irrigators, the female irrigators paying attention to gender aspects of water, women being irrigators, how do we bring all of these stakeholders together at the ground level to be able to have access to water. Again, we have done very little in this area in the LAC region, and something that I would certainly advocate and call upon, and I think that ICA is very well placed to do this, because one of the strengths of ICA is by being able to work not just with ministries of agriculture and departments of agriculture and departments of irrigation, but ICA also being able to work on the ground with NGOs and farmers groups and water users associations. I think that is a tremendous asset that ICA brings to the table in being able to regroup a lot of these institutions and farmers groups, gender groups, and water users groups together to be able to allocate water in an equitable way. So these are some of the things that we need to do. Absolutely, in decision making and transparency, we need to have better water information systems with data that can be used to help aid in balancing efficiency with equity in access to water. Now I come to the third point that I was asked to address, and that is what specific interventions can be done to help small and medium-scale farmers produce more food more efficiently using less water per unit of output. What is the way forward into the use of wastewater in agriculture, and how can institutions such as ICA support these efforts? But I think it's fair to say, after traveling through quite a bit of the Latin America Caribbean region, myself working in the region, that much, much more can be done in terms of water conservation practices. I see very limited attempts to impose and implement very strong water conservation strategies in agriculture. And what do I mean by this? Yes, there are drip irrigation systems as I travel through the region. In South America, Central America, the Caribbean, I see drip irrigation for sure. But drip irrigation is not enough, and not everybody is going to be able to have access to water and energy to use drip irrigation systems. We could do a lot more in terms of water conservation through better cropping practices, through better soil practices, through mulching, and conservation of water in the soil through mulching systems, straw mulches, plastic mulches, what kinds of crops? And here I talk about agroforestry crops, I talk about changes in our cropping systems that would allow us to retain more moisture in the soil and have that water available, especially through things like rainwater harvesting systems. We see very little attention to rainwater harvesting, very small, many projects and places, but a lot more can be done, I think, in rainwater harvesting for small farmers. Low energy precision applications and low pressure applications of water. Here I come to a new technology called precision irrigation, of which our university and particularly our faculty has played a very large role. Our Water Resources Center here at McGill, in terms of development of precision irrigation technologies, how do we map soil types, how do we use digital soil information from areas to be able to determine precisely what is the irrigation requirement for those different soils, so that we can apply water, specific amounts of water to very specific zones based on soil type, based on agroclimatological conditions, to develop systems of precision irrigation for small farmers, especially now with all of the new satellite technologies and remote sensing technologies that are available. I think we can do a lot more in terms of making recommendations to farmers on precision irrigation. The region has done very little, if anything, on this area, and we need to bring the technology of precision irrigation into Latin America and Caribbean. This leads me to the other point with respect to irrigation scheduling. There are now many new tools available for helping farmers, irrigation agencies, irrigation districts, and helping extension officers to determine precisely how much water needs to be applied to the soil on a real-time basis, using weather data from satellites that are, now we have a lot of satellite data available of rainfall and precipitation. You go to any hotel in the region, and the first thing you turn on is the weather channel, and you can get all of these weather predictions and rainfall predictions. And we have not been able to take that information out and use it in the agricultural sector to be able to guide farmers on how much water needs to be applied. I think IICA needs to be taking this a lot more seriously. IICA needs to be working with universities like McGill University that has leadership in this area, has experts in this area, to help IICA to advance this kind of technology through some pilot projects in the Latin America region. Use of wireless sensors for soil, crop, climate monitoring. This technology is now available. It's getting cheaper by the day. And IICA needs to get on top of it. IICA needs to be able to say that it is playing a leadership role in this area. I hope that IICA, one of the points that I was asked to address is how can IICA and McGill work together. And I think this is one area that we would be happy to work together with IICA on, to establish some of these pilot projects on use of climate data. And this is readily available data from satellites and remote sensing that we have access to, free data that nobody's making proper use of, I think, in the Latin America Caribbean region with INIC. Drainage improvements. This is another area that we need interventions on. Very little attention apart from Mexico, where in the northern parts of Mexico, I've seen extensive drainage investments, not so much for flood control, but drainage facility control and salt management in the semi-arid regions, the drier regions in northern Mexico. But there's a lot of potential to improve drainage, come up with new drainage design criteria for cropping systems, both in the flatter, fertile valleys and river plains, but also on the steepland areas where you have erosion and runoff. What kinds of drainage runoff control practices can be implemented to be able to increase water use efficiency and crop productivity outputs. And this brings us to water table management, again, new technologies in water table management, which ICA hasn't even touched, probably isn't even aware of some of these technologies, but again, technologies that we're pioneering here in our water research center, of how in the flatter river valley areas, we can control the water table with simple water control devices and structures to be able to provide water for crop growth during the dry season by recycling and recirculating water from the runoff periods and use it during the dry season. Absolutely, I agree in terms of wastewater use and irrigation. I see this particularly in the drier parts of Central America, in Guatemala, in Honduras, for example, Nicaragua, where we do have at sometimes shortages of water. But as we have increased urbanization and municipalities that are producing wastewater and very poor services, which you all know, you're all from Latin America and the Caribbean region, you travel region quite a bit, you know, you see how wastewater is just being disposed of without any proper treatment facilities. It's causing huge health problems, waste problems in the region, environmental degradation from poor disposal of waste and wastewater. And so I think ICA has to get on top of this situation with the ministries of agriculture, ministries of environment, ministries of water, because in many of these areas where these problems are occurring, they are occurring in agrarian areas, ICA should get in there and start to work with the different governmental agencies to be able to turn around a severe environmental degradation problem into something where we can reuse this wastewater, treat wastewater in lagoons and wetlands and so on, and recirculation ponds, and use that in some of the drier areas for supplemental irrigation water. Of course, it comes with health restrictions and health concerns. You have to have methodologies for the safe reuse of wastewater so that you're not contaminating people, consumers of fresh fruits and vegetables produced with wastewater. So you need to put a whole system of practices, methodologies, and best practices in place to be able to adequately and properly use wastewater in agriculture without causing good health impacts, not just from the consumption of the products, the food products that might be contaminated, but also the workers, the agricultural workers and the farmers in the fields that are working with wastewater. What do they need to do in terms of protective measures when they work with wastewater? So some wastewaters can be used, some cannot be used. How do we differentiate those? How do we classify those? What can be used safely? What cannot be used? What crops can be used for? This is all very open, virgin territory for ICA to exploit, but ICA needs to have the support of the technical experts in this area. And again, we're willing to come to the rescue of ICA if it so requires, if it wants to work in these areas. I go back again, but ICA has a role in technology transfer, in advisory services, to farmers, and I think more importantly, ICA should start to develop some pilot projects, some pilot sites. ICA cannot be everything to everybody. You don't have the money and the resources to tackle all the problems of irrigation and water management to every single one of your member countries. But where can you prioritize some countries based on different socioeconomic conditions and start to establish some pilot projects in some key areas where you can implement some of these technologies and best practices as demonstration projects to test them at farmers, to get farmer feedback? We can design and conceptualize things as best as we can in the lab and in the office, but until you actually put them in farmers' holdings and get farmers' experience with it, hear back from the farmers, what are the advantages, the disadvantages, what are their problems in managing the technology, how to make it user-friendly for farmers. We can only do this by working with some pilot projects to get real experience on the ground with farmers, farmers groups, and water users associations. So I plead for IICA to get on top of this. I understand that your Board of Governors meeting that's coming up, I think next week or week after, is on water management, but I don't know what you're proposing there. I hope at some stage somebody will share with me what exactly you're proposing at your Board of Governors meeting, and maybe the document that comes out afterwards you can share with people like us so that we can know what you are thinking of as well. So I come to the fourth point that was asked, and that is what actors need to be more involved in providing solutions, what sort of public-private sector partnerships of models have been effective at addressing the current water and food security situation, can these models be scaled up, and what are the challenges. I would like to draw IICA's attention to some very successful work that is going on the African continent and in Asia with respect to public-private partnerships and models. The Latin America Caribbean region, when I look at what is going on around the world, it has been slow to take on, it's not bold enough. And the private sector in Latin America and the Caribbean has not been as bold as the private sector, the indigenous private sector in Africa and Asia. And I think IICA has to look at that and use its global network to look at some of these models. I bring to your attention, for example, some work that we're involved in through my own work as a member of the Board of Governors of ICRISAT, one of the ECG centers in India, which I will be leaving tomorrow for our Board of Governors meeting in India, where we have got some very successful large Indian entrepreneurs who are investing in seed technology and improved seed varieties for different crops, primarily the crops in which ICRISAT works, the five mandated crops of ICRISAT, which includes crops such as millet, sorghum, chickpea, and so on. And these indigenous Indian investors are taking their money and their technology to African farmers and the private sector in Africa, small cooperatives, women's cooperatives in Africa, to help to create women's cooperatives that can provide seed. And one of the problems we have in food security and agriculture is that small farmers are working with seed varieties for many crops that are outdated, they're not viable any longer. And so how do you get new and improved seed varieties out into women's cooperatives, into farmers' organizations? You can't leave it to government and the National Agricultural Research Centers. They don't have the capacity, they don't have the resources, some of them don't have the mechanisms to get it out. And so I think it's by being able to link the private sectors from different parts in a more cooperative way, I think it's going to be successful, some of it with public money as well to help to get started. So I think linking farmers to markets is a key driver. It helps to bring the private sector in through a marketing arrangement to help to provide the technologies, the new varieties, the water top technologies, and so on, to be able to have farmers adopt these technologies to meet certain market demands. We don't have a strong enough link between the large private entrepreneurial marketers and individual farmers. This needs to be strengthened. And so these market demands for high value crops will push farmers to use water more efficiently. It will provide stability of crop yields, improve crop quality. We need to set up seed and fertilizer companies, to have a much more distributed private sector network, a much more diversified private sector network. The private sector cannot just focus exclusively on providing fertilizer and seed. Water is a very critical package, part of the package, of being able to ensure crop yields. It's not all just pesticides and fertilizer and seed. How does this diversified private sector enterprise bring also irrigation advice, irrigation supplies, irrigation advice to farmers, I think is important. We also need to do a lot more work in Latin America and Caribbean with the insurance companies, as has been done in India and in Africa. I cannot think, as I go through the region, a single large insurance, private insurance company that is taking significant risk in agriculture through provision of risk insurance products and services and for drought mitigation, for example, and drought protection. And I think that the Caribbean and Latin American governments need to work much more aggressively with the insurance companies to get them to invest in advisory services, risk management services to growers in the area of risk to drought and floods and so on in water. Much more to be done in agri-consulting companies that provide data on climate and soil moisture that can predict irrigation requirements very weak in Latin America and the Caribbean. And of course the challenges are financial. Who will pay? We can't expect governments with their limited resources to always be the one doing this. Governments don't have the financial or technical capacity to do this, but we need to be able for the private sector to take up much more risk in agriculture, particularly for small farmers and medium farms. The private sector tends to work with the larger farmers because it's a secure investment. They know they'll get their money back, the same for insurance companies. But we must not look at the small farmers and the medium farmers as risky players. They need to earn a living as well. You know, the backbone of many of our countries are the small farmers. And we need to be able to amalgamate up these small farmers through better mechanisms in terms of markets. If we can link small farmers to larger markets, I think this will be one of the benefits in terms of providing stimulus for these models that we talk about with the private sector getting more involved in irrigation and water management. So finally, what can McGill do in relation to these very many topics that we've talked about today? I mentioned last year when I was in San Jose, the work of our McGill Institute for Global Security, our base center for water resources management. I made an extensive presentation on our CARICOM food security project. One of the things that we have not touched on so much, but very much linked to climate and water, is greenhouse gases, mitigation of greenhouse gases, very much linked to water productivity, soil productivity, and crop productivity. What can we do in terms of carbon sequestration, biochar, to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and improve soil and water conservation? I bring to you, or I offer to you, some of the work we're doing in West Africa, in water and food security to promote the concept of the African market gardens through tribal pumps, solar energy systems, use of drought resistant crops, agroecological soil mapping, development of water resources, inventories, water harvesting techniques, irrigation scheduling, which I talked about before, using the new tools of weather data, soil and crop data. Precision irrigation, something that we can help you with, conservation and agriculture. If you look on our website for our Global Food Security Center, you'll see the work that we're doing in Colombia on potato production with small farmers, women farmers. And I think this is a very exciting project because what has happened in some of these rural highland areas of Colombia is women farmers have lost some of the indigenous species of potatoes, and we have gone to modern varieties of potatoes that require high inputs of fertilizers, pesticides, and that causes environmental degradation. How can we use new genomic technologies and molecular genetic plant breeding technologies to breed some of the resistance of pests and diseases and so on into higher yielding varieties to keep some of the indigenous species and to make a product that can be used, that the women in rural areas are accustomed to using, but have lost it through the erosion of genetic resources to provide diets, nutritious diets in hillside, poor rural areas. I bring to your attention to a project in which Keith Andrews from IICA has been very instrumental in Guatemala to bring together McGill University and IDRC on a project on food and nutrition security mapping and strategy analysis in Guatemala. This is a project that I know Keith Andrews and Audie Barnett have piloted, have promoted with us. We're very proud of that work that has been done. I think that is the kind of thing that we can also continue to work on between McGill and IICA. So finally, how can our institutions, I think, create some of these advisory services in water, food security, nutrition, where we have some priority pilot areas that can be identified, and we can work together with some funding from the Inter-American Development Act, the Government of Canada, and philanthropic agencies as well. We should not forget the foundations and philanthropy as a source of funding. So these are the points that I would like to emphasize in my presentation today, and I thank you very much for this opportunity to present these ideas, and I would be happy to answer any questions that you might have on this. Thank you very much.
Thank you to you, Dr. Madramootoo. Here we have a question from our colleague, Daniela. Please, Daniela.
Hi, Dr. Chandra. Thanks for this pretty enlightening presentation. I'm always really interested in knowing the experiences of taking climate information and climate data to decision-making in the field, especially for smallholder agriculture, because I know how difficult it is to interpret this kind of information and just turn it into information that can be really useful to make decisions in farm. And so I'm curious about this project you mentioned in the Caribbean, if you've been able to link this information you've created or these information systems to small farmers or family farmers.
Yes, sure. Let me say that the work that we have done on climate change and water information systems and so on has not really, it's not the kind of thing that farmers themselves will make use of and make access to that data. I think that data and information systems and climate change data is more geared to the policy makers and the decision makers. And it's working with them, or they working with this information, being able to bring it out to small farmers, not so much to the farmers directly, but in terms of the kinds of advisory services and technology input, advice that they are providing to the farmers. So I think you will always find it's going to be extremely difficult to take climate change information from any climate model or from any data information system and make it directly usable to the farmer. I think we're in the Latin America and the Caribbean needs a lot more help is bringing this data out to the decision makers so we can empower the decision makers to make the right decisions and understand. I mean, our politicians in Latin America and the Caribbean are extremely famous for going around and talking about climate change. They can talk about the politics of climate change and why the politics of climate change is important to be addressed. But many of our politicians of all political stripes have a very weak understanding after that. After they've spoken at the high political level, they have a very weak knowledge of how to take data and information and turn it into products and services that ministries of agriculture, departments of irrigation can actually use. And because they have a weak understanding of that and can't articulate that very clearly, in the same, as a result of that, some of the decision makers then put it aside. They don't pay the attention that it needs to get. And I think that more needs to be done in terms of taking hard information, hard facts, and hard data, and turn it into products and services that these agencies can then take out to farmers. That's what I think is the gap at the present time.
Well, there's no questions at the chat room. So thank you very much for your presentation, Dr. Madramootoo. Thank you very much for your time. We hope to see you again and also to work with you again. So thank you very much. Have a great day. Thank you to everybody to join us. And I wish you a nice flight to India. I wish you the best.
How many, do you know how many people participated in the seminar this morning? Do you have an idea?
We can show you. We can send you later the report of all the connections we had.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. And you can mention to the participants that if they wish to email me for more information, that's I'd be happy to do that.
Okay, Doctor. Yeah, you people is hearing you at this moment.
Okay. Thank you so much.
No thanks to you.
Okay.
Have a great
bye-bye.
Day. Bye.
You too. Bye-bye.